what I want to do today in terms of getting into a conversation about the state of the university is to talk about change just a little bit. I want to talk, frankly, about some of the challenges that the university faces. And I want to talk about what I see as a way forward through and beyond those challenges and where I think we're going in that regard. And then I want to talk about what I think is going to be critical to our being able to deal with whatever the issues are that face this institution and to be able to confidently chart a course for this institution where we know we can achieve the goals that we set. I mean, think about one of the slides that didn't make it into this slideshow. It was one that I asked the question. It was one of those fill-in-the-blank sentences. It said, change is blank until blank. And my point for that slide, and I want to mention it, is that because I think it's important to some of the kinds of things that we have had to face and will continue to face. The sentence that I was focusing on is that change is slow. We tend to see change as slow over time, change as one of those things that happens fairly slowly. But change tends to be slow until it's not. Something happens that causes rapid change within systems, and then all of the systems affected by that change have to adapt to that change. Ask the people up in Princeville, they'll tell you. They weren't expecting that flood. But now that it has happened, they've got to look at what they do next. When we look at this institution as an example, this institution has undergone rapid change in leadership, 4 chancellors in 3 years. All of the literature on higher education says very clearly, when you have that much change at the leadership helm, you can expect ripples throughout the institution. People get nervous. People start to wonder what's going to happen next. There are concerns that start to arise. Rapid change causes concern, but rapid change also brings opportunity. Rapid change also brings the ability to sit, to think, to reason, and to make new kinds of decisions. We lost an American hero just prior to the holiday. John Glenn passed. And one of the things that I remember about his, as he became an astronaut, and he used to talk about relative to him, I think he was the one that actually said this, that they were interviewing people for the astronaut corps. And they asked the question, if something, you're in orbit around the Earth, there's nobody that can get to you, you got to make a decision and there's an emergency. In 30 seconds, your spacecraft is going to explode. 30 seconds, you've got to do something. In 30 seconds, what would you do? And there were a wide variety of answers that came from astronauts around that. But the question that came through, or the answer that came through, is most important. Said, what I would do is think for 27 seconds and then initiate. One of the things that I think we need to be reminded of as an academic institution, that thinking is our game. Thinking is what we do. Thinking about difficult problems, coming up with solutions to different problems, is who we are. That's what we provide for this community that would not be here in this community if Elizabeth City State University were not here. That's what we provide to this region that would not be here if Elizabeth City State University were not here. Now, there are other institutions in the region, obviously. This town happens to be blessed with 3 academic institutions, the oldest community college in the state of North Carolina, a very good Bible college, and Elizabeth City State University. But what we do, the way we do it, what we bring to the table, were we not here, the region would suffer significantly. Our mission, we were established to do just exactly what it is the communities that we serve need right now. That is to impact economic development through education. That was our initial founding purpose. That is our purpose now. And we must think about that. We must come up with solutions that help these communities that we serve grow in those ways. So as we've gone through change, as we look at our challenges, let's not lose sight of what our focus should be. Like a lot of you, I did a lot of reading over the holidays. And one of the things that struck me was a passage, and you know, they say in higher education, you give credit for where you borrow things from, but you borrow liberally from your colleagues. As I was reading through a book, it struck me, this passage jumped out at me, and it was how reading about how institutions have made transformations and how they've looked at themselves and made decisions to move in different directions and grow and enhance the institutions. And one of the slogans that was adopted by one of the institutions, Bucknell, was what we do and the way we will describe how we will proceed is that we will engage, we will educate, and through that we will empower. So engage, educate, empower. Again, that's who we are. That's what we do. That's what these communities that we are charged with serving need. So a lot of what I'm going to talk about today is going to come back to that concept of engagement, education, and empowerment for our faculty, for our staff, for our students, for the communities that we serve. When I look back at the year, you know, we came in with challenges. One of the great challenges that we faced was the fact that we had just received an update on an advanced notice. You all heard about it slightly later. Advanced notice of an interim audit that had been done, that it focused on our admissions offices and our financial aid, enrollment management areas, admissions, financial aid, the registrar's office and those areas. And it was an important part of what happened and what set the tone for this past year. Well, why am I talking about that? Because this is something I believe I have to communicate to you openly and honestly about. I have to say to you that these are challenges that we face, and I have to let you know that we are perfectly capable of managing these challenges. And I want you to know where we are. I want the public to know where we are. I want everybody to know that we're on top of these things. And the way this chancellor sees challenges like that is if you find a problem, the issue is not the problem, the issue is how you fix it. What do you do to go after it and make sure that same problem doesn't continue to plague you? So let me give you just a brief flyover and update. What happened? There was an internal audit. That was an audit done by the General Administration's internal audit group. That group came in, they found some challenges. They registered those challenges. We immediately went to work fixing those issues, addressing those recommendations that were identified. But as life would have it in higher education, things are complicated. The news stories that were associated with that were nationwide. Our accrediting agency, SACS Council of Colleges, looked at that and said, well, what's going on up there at Elizabeth City? Maybe we need to be a little bit careful. And they have to do their job. They do, because if they don't look at us critically and know that we're looking at ourselves critically, there are other entities that would come in and tell you and them how to do business in ways that would be a lot more detrimental than what SACS could do. So Sachs says, okay, we're going to put you on warning. We need for you to investigate this. We need for you to let us know you're on top of this. So we've been working on addressing the questions that Sachs has asked us relative to that. And in the interim here, what we wind up with, because we're part of the state of North Carolina and because our internal audits are become public documents, this became a national news story. Sachs got concerned about it. They registered their concern about it. It is not surprising then that the state auditor's office says, okay, while we're doing our compliance audits this year, we want to make sure that we're looking at this too. So essentially they looked at the same point in time, the same period, and essentially validated the findings that had been found in the internal audit. Now, that's the lay of the land. That's what happened. What you may or may not know as much about is the amount of work that has been done to address those issues. What we've been after for the last year is to look at the issues associated in the internal audit one by one, making sure that policies are changed, making sure that procedures are updated, making sure that training is done. All of those kinds of things are being and have been addressed. With the questions from Sachs, we have been preparing. We prepared an initial list of questions. They will be sending in a visitation team in April. They will come, and we're confident based on what we're putting together and what the follow-up from the initial internal audit will be reporting. We're pretty confident that we're going to be able to calm the concerns about those particular issues. Then with the internal audit that compliance audit that was part of, and incidentally, let me make clear, there are multiple audits that we go through each year. There is the financial audit of the university that looks at how the university is handling the public trust with the funds that it gets. And I want to be clear, for 4 years in a row, Elizabeth City State University has had no financial audit findings. So we're not talking about the institution's finances. As a matter of fact, I would argue that the institution probably needs to be given commendations for being able to balance budgets within a constantly shrinking economy for the institution and continuing to do the business of the institution. I'm real proud of that. I don't want to get that mixed up with this compliance audit. With the compliance audit, what happened was they came in and looked at policies and procedures in those same areas that the internal audit looked at. And one of the things that we're in conversation with the internal auditors at General Administration and the State Auditor's Office can we at least look at the fact that these are not new issues. These are issues that had been found earlier. They have been addressed. Let's look at what's been done to address it and make sure we're focusing on what the delta is, what's left undone, and make clear that our faculty, our students, and our publics know that these are issues we're just continuing to work through and work on, and we're doing it successfully. So I wanted to update you on that because I think communications is going to be the key to our success in the future here at Elizabeth City State University. As a matter of fact, I would argue that communications is going to be one of the more critical issues for all institutions. So when an institution starts to look at where it wants to go and what it wants to do, I believe that where you start is with who you are. I believe that where you start is with your institutional core values. One of the things that I've started to do whenever I'm on the road, whenever I'm talking to, whether it's alumni, whether it's recruits, whether it is public agencies and governmental agencies, I always go back to our core values because I think Elizabeth City State University established a set of core values years and years ago that has served it well in terms of being able to direct the university forward and come through previous challenges, and I think they'll serve us well in the future. Number one, accountability. We will accept the responsibility for the decisions we make and the actions we take. That is something that as administrators, as faculty, as staff, and it is a value that imparting to our students will prepare them well for whatever futures they face. So I think that is one that we ought to incorporate into everything we do. We ought to think about it daily. Accountability is an important part of who we are and what we do. Diversity. You know, I had mentioned on other occasions that I looked at both of the histories of the university here at Elizabeth City, and you're blessed to have two written histories of the institutions, one by Evelyn Johnson and the other more recent one by Dr. Glenn Bowman. Both of these historical accounts, if you don't have a copy of them, you should get one, and after getting them, you should read them, because this is an amazing institution in a lot of ways. Many amazing personalities have worked here, have invested in making this institution a standout institution. But in 1935, the institution had a conversation about diversity. I would argue that in 1935, having a conversation about diversity wasn't the easiest thing to do. But in 35, this institution made a commitment that the people who would teach and who would guide the learning process here would have to be committed to this value of diversity, that they would have to be committed to the idea that they would respect all peoples and their values and incorporate them, or at least try to understand them in the teaching and the learning that took place at this institution. This is an important value for Elizabeth City State University, and one that is relevant for today and one that we should hold sacred. Excellence. Excellence is going to be the key value, I think, that makes us different from a lot of other institutions that have faced some of the same kinds of challenges that we face. Our commitment to excellence, your commitment to excellence, your commitment to getting the job done for the people that you serve, not just getting it done though, but getting it done at a high level, continuing to demand high performance out of your students, continuing to demand high performance out of your colleagues, continuing to demand high performance out of your administrators, is going to be one of the values that is one of our core values, and it's going to be one of the things that will serve us well as we move forward. And then finally, teaching students holistically, helping students understand the charges that we have responsibility for, helping our students, helping our colleagues develop curricula that tie things together, to understand that in the world that we live in, an ever-shrinking world because of the technology and access to information, we must understand that things are connected, and understanding how they are connected and understanding how to connect them and make useful decisions around things that happen in your life are all part of what happens when you understand the holistic approach to teaching and learning and living. So these are four core values that the institution endorsed many years ago. These are four core values, I think, that will guide us well into the future. One of the things that is important also is that we know where we are in context. The slide that's up there now has to do with the University of North Carolina strategic plan, the system strategic plan that is being developed. They have actually identified five core principles that they are working on and developing a strategic plan that will be, they expect to finish it up within the next couple of months, and it'll be rolled out across the system. What I found important about, now I sat in the room for many of the conversations as they were developing the five core goals and also going into depth about each of the five. When you look at the access goal, we've talked a lot about Elizabeth City State University being an access institution. We are committed to that as our goal, but we are also responsible for helping to define and help people understand what that means. How do you connect access and excellence? That's something this institution has a history of doing very well, and that's an area in which this institution can lead. The fifth one down there, the excellent and diverse institutions, is one that I think is critically important. And it's important that we understand how that fits from our perspective. The conversation about excellent and diverse institutions was deliberately placed in the strategic goals for the UNC system, because there were people who recognized that institutions like Elizabeth City State University had a special mission, a special place, and a special way of doing things. It is the opportunity for us to distinguish ourselves as the type of institution we are, rather than evaluating ourselves against metrics that should be used for institutions that are not at all like us. This is a goal that we need to examine, we need to understand, and we need to gear this institution once the strategic plan is released, finalized and released, to help people understand how we already know we are that kind of institution. We are an institution that adds diversity to the university system, not only in who we are, but how we go about doing things. From there, I wanted to just briefly talk about Elizabeth City State University's strategic goals, because I don't think we talk about these enough as a university. One of the things that did not happen that I had thought had already happened was that our strategic plan is out on the web. But in order to find our strategic plan right now, what you can do is search for it on our homepage, and you'll find it on the homepage or attached to the page of business and finance. We need to give it its own page, because we need to start talking about where we are relative to the strategic plan and how we're doing with operational goals each year that follow on from that strategic plan. We've got six strategic goals that drive the university. And it's important that you understand that these strategic goals will drive the big picture of where we're going, that out of those strategic goals will come the operational plans that direct what we do year to year. Out of those strategic goals and operational plans will come the way we go about doing budgeting each year, how we will set priorities, and the things we will invest in going forward. So this strategic plan is more than just an idle document in terms of the university life. It's something that we need to pay attention to. The first strategic plan, recruit, retain, graduate students. Students that have been exposed to an excellent faculty and go out with core values that prepare them well for the world that they are going to face. Number two, strengthen the academic quality by promoting a climate of intellectual excellence. That you heard the provost say, and I one of the things with all of the moving and so forth, what the provost told you is that this year, for the first time in what, as far as we can tell so far, maybe a decade, the university has been approved for its first new program. Now, that's a first, that's okay for now. But over the course of the next few years, we want to move to the position of being one of the institutions that develops a reputation for being the most innovative. We're going to look at all of our curricula. We want to commend the faculty for making the decision to endorse the fact that all of our curricula will move from the 124 to 128 category to the 120-hour category for graduation. That alone will require that all curricula are examined. That will then put us in a position to talk about where our curricula are relative to 21st century needs, and it will set the stage for the innovation that we as an institution need and are good at relative to the populations that we're working with. So we're going to be looking at that and how we will perform relative to that goal. Number three, serve the people of North Carolina and particularly the 21 counties that are our target, northeastern North Carolina targeted area. We are an important variable in this area. We are a critical variable in this area. When I started off, one of the first things I did was to talk about the economic impact of Elizabeth City State University on the counties that we touch directly and on the state in general. For every $1 in tax dollars that North Carolina invests in Elizabeth City State University, the university returns to those counties $3 in benefit. The economic advantage. Now, for those of you that looked at your portfolios, your investment portfolios over the Christmas holidays, if you were getting a 3-to-1 return on your investments, you'd be grinning really, really big right now. Okay? When I say Elizabeth City State University is critical to the region, this is a true statement. It is a documented statement. For every $1 in tax dollars invested in Elizabeth City, we return $3 in economic impact. What is even more impressive, though, and what is important for us to understand, and this is something that it's very difficult to get people to understand because or to focus on, because we tend to focus, just like the in communications and in news cycles, we focus on what's important to us. We tend to focus on bad news more than we focus on good news. It is very difficult to get people to invest in things that will avoid expenditures. When we started to look at what happens when money is invested in the university, and the fact that it enhances people's life chances, and then those people go out into the world and become productive, income-earning citizens, and then do not use the kinds of social services and public services that would cause an increase in spending in those areas, what we find is that for every one tax dollar invested in Elizabeth City State University, there is a return of more than $9 in cost avoidance. You know, I talk a lot about that Washington Monthly ranking that has ranked us number one for the last 4 years in terms of best value because of that economic impact that, because of the social impact that we have. Our students come to us at a level that in many cases is very, very needy. When they graduate, they have capabilities and they go out and contribute in very big ways. That delta that is caused by who we take in and who we turn out allows us to avoid the social services costs that would go along with public health, public welfare, and public incarceration. Those are the kinds of things that we don't talk about enough, but the reality is, were it not for institutions like this one, more dollars would be required to manage the human loss that would take place. Number four, strengthen the university's internal controls. Now, I want to be clear on this because these next two may sound very, very similar, But they're two different things. When we start talking about strengthening the university's internal control, here's a challenge that we face as a university. When our students come in, they see the university. What we inside the university tend to see is a group of units. And one of my goals as chancellor is to help this institution understand that we are not a collection of loosely associated entities that share parking lots. What we are is a university. And as a university, there has to be that kind of siloing is good, because there's expertise that comes along with disciplinary depth. There is expertise that comes along with working with the business office, understanding how the business operations of the institution, with student affairs, understanding student activities, student housing, and all of those areas, with enrollment management, understanding that flow. But that's not what our public see. What our public see is the university. And what we have to do as a university is figure out how to make those blends, how to do those crosswalks, so that our publics never see the seams. If a student or a parent or a customer of at any level walks in, a vendor walks into one of our offices and asks a question, we have to commit to knowing enough about this institution that we can get that person to the person that can answer their question without giving them the impression that they're being run around to a group of areas and nobody's really trying to figure out what the question is and what the appropriate answer should be. We are a university. When we talk about looking at our operations, we're talking about blending our operations. We're talking about knowing what happens over in other offices. So when an issue arises, a person walks in and says, you know, I have a question about X. The answer is not, well, you need to go over to that office to do that. The answer is, listen, let me make a phone call to my friend so-and-so, and I think we can get your answer there. And if you have to go over there, they'll be expecting you. That's the kind of service. Really, that's the kind of service that will make the difference in how people perceive us. We've got to know enough about what happens in each of our offices that we can make that work. Number five is about the fiscal aspect of the university. You know, we have a very, very good fiscal staff. I can't say this enough. With all that has gone on, with all the challenges that Elizabeth City State University has faced, with all of the changes that have taken place, the group that handles the finances of the university. Now I got to warn you. You might not want to see how they make sausage. But they are good at what they do. And with as someone who has seen this work at other institutions, it's no different at any other institution. The reality is you've got to have people that know how to manage those accounts and know how to make things work for you and know how to explain what they did with every dollar to the auditors and others that come in when they're asking, how are you handling your money? So it really is important that we take a look at constantly getting better in those areas. Pillar six, or goal six, expand the educational opportunities through commitment to student-centered culture. Now, I'm going to stress this one just a little bit more, in the sense that I asked my cabinet a month or so ago. We took a cabinet meeting and I said, tell me what the most important thing is. What is the most important thing we do? And we talked it around. But at the end of the day, the product that the world is looking to Elizabeth City State University for is students. The product that we turn out that people will judge us by more than anything else we do is students. We've got some exciting things going on in some other areas, and we will continue to expand areas in which we will have exciting things going on. But the student experience is the thing that will make or break us. We have to absorb that into our thinking. We have to think about how everything we do affects the student experience. When we design curricula, when we design student activities, when we look at what students are doing outside of class, for you know the measure is they spend 20% of the time in class with the faculty and 80% somewhere else. We've got to learn how to take advantage of that 80% and elevate the thinking and the work and the learning that takes place in that process. So that student-centered environment is going to be really important. Now, I'm going to speed up a little bit because I'm going to talk about some things. The reason I focus on communication so much in my conversations is, and there's a background story on this, and I'll tell it at some other time. It had to do with life or death situations that I was placed in. But the reality is this. We communicate a lot. This campus communicates a lot. You all talk a lot about what's going on at Elizabeth City State University. We all do. But what happens is the volume is turned up on the challenges, and it tends to be turned down on the good news that's going on. So what I want to do for just a few minutes is go through just quickly some of the kinds of things that are happening in our environment that are really exciting. And let me tell you, at the end of this, what I'm looking for is to encourage you, because what's going to happen is I'm going to go through these next slides, and you're going to say, well, why didn't he say something about my program here? Or why didn't he say something about the things we're doing over there? What I want to ask you to do, and we're going to ask our media and public relations area to gear up. We're asking them to gear up and be ready for this. We want you to start bringing those stories to us. We want you to start calling us and letting us know when these good news stories are happening so that we can gather them so that Elizabeth City State University has a constant repository, has a deep repository of good news stories and a constant outflow of the good news stories, things that are happening in our environment. When we started looking at this campus, we look at the research that's going on. We're not known for our research as a campus, but the work that Dr. Banerjee is doing over in cancer research and has been doing for the last 16 years ago or so has established in that particular area an area of excellence. And what has happened out of that is that he's preparing cancer researchers that are going out and getting master's and doctoral degrees and working on significant cancer research around the country. This is Elizabeth City State University faculty doing this. When we look at the work that we're doing with internationally, the Kenya project has taken off, literally. And we're working with the Kenyan Wildlife Commission there, trying to impact the deadly impact, trying to affect the deadly impact of poaching in the Kenya nature reserves. Worldwide, people, you set up late night and you watch the commercials and they want you to save the elephants and others. But essentially what is happening is somebody has to monitor. There has to be an effective way of looking at what the bad guys are doing in that environment and how the good guys can help mitigate that. Our faculty in aviation science applied for a Department of Justice grant and are working with the Kenyan Wildlife Mission to affect just that. We are working to get lightweight planes into their use with the idea that they will know how both to fly them, to service them, and they will be used to monitor the game reserves at a whole higher level. This is work internationally that Elizabeth City State University is doing. When we start looking at our students, our product, who are we turning out? Alana Simmons. Now, and this is a story about how tragedy can breed innovation. Alana Simmons' grandfather was one of the nine people killed at the Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, South Carolina last year. A family tragedy. Alana made a decision that rather than being angry about it, rather than being victimized by it, that she would do something about it. And she started putting together a series of workshops and going out saying to people, let's substitute understanding for hate. Let's find a way to work together through these things and work through and with people to get things done in a more positive fashion. Angelo Sharpless. Now, I know people say, okay, you got somebody who is playing for the Harlem Globetrotters. The historians in the audience know a little bit about the history of the Harlem Globetrotters and where they fit in the context of American basketball and where they fit as ambassadors for the United States of America. The Harlem Globetrotters is not just a basketball team. They are an organization that travel globally and travel nationally to spread a word of working together and playing together. And they do it through laughter, but the message behind the organization is coming together. For a young man from Plymouth, North Carolina, to find his way onto the Harlem Globetrotters team is no small feat, but his path was through Elizabeth City State University. Most of you have had a chance to meet Warren Judge. Warren Judge is the executive officer out at the Coast Guard base at this point. Now, Warren Judge's story, if you haven't heard it, you need to find a way into his presence when he's talking about his growing up, the challenges that he faced, how he got to Elizabeth City State University in the first place, and how Elizabeth City State University changed his life. These are amazing stories. These are great stories. These are the examples. These are the proof of concept of why an access institution is important in the University of North Carolina system. Warren is a great friend. He's a great friend to the university. He's going to be a great asset to us as we try to move forward, as we continue to move forward in enhancing relationships with the Coast Guard base. Tyler Pryor came to Elizabeth City State University with the goal of becoming a Coast Guard pilot. We were able to facilitate that goal through our C-SPY program, through our connection through our aviation science program, through our connection with the Coast Guard. Tyler found his way into the Coast Guard aviation program. And I think the last sentence on this particular slide is really important. According to the Office of Coast Guard Recruitment Command, Pryor was the only one selected this year for the Wilkes Flight Initiative program that he went into. We're turning out exceptional products. We're turning out students that are going to continue to do exceptional things. We need to let people know that. And you need to know it. do we do things that people in this city should and in this region should be coming to campus to enjoy? One of the things, and you all know that I enjoy coming to the arts programs. I think that's one of the things the university can add that add to a living environment, a level of living that enhances the community and encourages others to want to be part of that community. We had put together on this campus, the in this auditorium, a concert, and I think the Espinoza described it as an experiment. You brought together different groups, combined different musical ensembles, combined them in different ways, and did very different kinds of music. You had works by Ravenel, Schubert, and Villalobos performed, and then switched over to a jazz concert and performed works by Horace Silver and Herbie Hancock and Duke Ellington. This is a community that is growing in its appreciation and its understanding of the arts. Elizabeth City State University has a place in that growth, and we need to look at how we invest in that growth. When I got here a year ago, within probably the first 60 days I was here, Maurice came to see me. Those of you that have had the opportunity to teach Maurice know that he's a go-getter. He doesn't take no for an answer. He's going to keep pushing. He came. He made an appointment with me and came to my office to pitch an idea he had. I sent him back to the department because this is an innovative idea that that he's still pushing on that could develop an opportunity for the department to make money based upon or to bring in revenue based on the skill sets that they are teaching students to develop. Maurice has started a music company. He has identified with students here at Elizabeth City State University who have significant talent in the arts and blended them with students who have significant talent in business and communications. He has put together a small entertainment company and is pushing that talent and building a business as an entrepreneur as he's completing his degree at Elizabeth City State University. These are the kinds of things. When I said coming in, we need to be teaching students not just how to get a job, but how to create jobs. This is an example of how that works. We're looking to get this mobile science lab in the parking lot of every school in 21 counties that we are serving currently, or that we target. But I would like to get it. I have a goal to get it onto campuses in a much broader context. A few weeks ago, I did a little snippet that was put out online, just introducing the fact that we had this mobile STEM lab available. And I said to students, if you're a student or a parent who's interested in STEM and you'd like to know more about this, give a call and ask that this come to, talk to your school administrator and give ask them to call and ask if it can come to visit. All over Virginia, Southern Virginia, and Eastern North Carolina, we're starting to get calls now. People want to know when they can book this mobile STEM lab to come to their campus. This is a rolling billboard, if you will, but it's packed with science or STEM in STEM opportunities and STEM blocking on the word. It's experiences that takes those experiences and has the goal of creating a love of STEM among the students that we need to both seed with that love and recruit as students going forward for Elizabeth City State University. One of the things that we have been able to do since we've been here is start to talk broadly in communities about what would be the role of Elizabeth City State University in the economic development conversation. And what I found in listening to in various communities and to the people who are responsible for the economic development in the area is that they need partners. And what we can do that others can't do as well is we can convene. We can pull together thinkers that can focus on challenges and proffer ideas about how to meet those challenges. We can host meetings here where conversations can take place as relatively neutral ground for the counties that we would be trying to impact. As a university, if we act like a university, if we do what we do to engage, to educate, to empower, then what we will find is that there is a very important place at the table in these community conversations for Elizabeth City State University. One of the other things that we've had as a goal is to get more involved in the community. The idea of getting the community onto campus, getting the campus into the community, has found its way into a couple of initiatives. The faith community came to us, and a couple of members of the faith community came to us and asked us if we would allow them to do this Stop Hunger Now initiative over in Vaughn Center a month or so ago. We quickly agreed to allow that to happen. And on one Sunday afternoon, over 400 people came together in the Vaughn Center and packaged over 91,000 meals that were sent to Haiti and other countries that where there are nourishment needs around the world. Elizabeth City and Elizabeth City State University was able again to have global impact because we came together as a community. These are the kinds of projects we want to look at and continue to look at. The Viking Volunteer Corporation, when I walked in the door, one of the first projects, one of the first proposals that came to me was this idea of how do we organize our campus community to participate with the broader community in Elizabeth City and Pasquotank County. The idea of this Viking volunteer group was proffered, and it turned out to be an idea waiting for someone to initiate it. We found that our faculty, our staff, our students were willing volunteers. All we needed was a system to connect the people who wanted to volunteer with the needs out there in the community. This has become a very popular project in the community. We've been in the process of working to get additional partners to the table. This particular transparency, it when we signed the agreement with the Coast Guard, we are now, and it's important that you understand what this agreement, this is a memorandum of understanding with the Coast Guard. This is not the Coast Guard base, this is the U.S. Coast Guard. We have a memorandum of understanding with them. And we talk about the things we intend to provide for the Coast Guard. We intend to provide Coast Guard families with the opportunity to continue their education here. We want to be their educational institution of choice. We are going after military-affiliated students, military-affiliated families, because we want them to see us as a viable option. But what this MOU does is for those of you that are looking for opportunities to bring speakers in, looking for examples of leadership, looking for ways to incorporate what's happening in life-saving and in all of the various areas that the Coast Guard gets involved in, they are willing to provide us with source professionals, SMEs, to come in and speak in your classes, to work with your students, to be part of the Elizabeth City State University environment. But for the faculty, you've got to look at what it is they have that you think you can incorporate into your system, and then ask for those kinds of things, because the MOU says they will go on the line and help us do that. And we'll do this through Warren Judge. He is very much committed to making sure that agreement works. The Veterans Center, we brought that up. We put some additional resources into trying to make it work. Again, we want to send a strong message. Our ranking went up this year among military friendly institutions. We intend to continue to raise our rankings in those areas. Serving those who have served our country is an important part of what we do. It is also an important part, if you think historically, the investment that the U.S. has made in supporting its veterans has almost always elevated higher education institutions. Because as they seek those educational benefits, looking for the institutions that can provide them, you're talking about a ready student with a ready source of income. And what we have to do is provide them with the kinds of services that they need. So this is a market that we are going after significantly. We've also reestablished some relationships with some old friends. At Halifax Community College, at one point we had a very active remote teacher education program there. We've gone in and now we've talked to them about reestablishing that teacher education program. We're going to be delivering it at a distance and recruiting some of those students to main campus here. We also will be working on establishing our criminal justice and social work programs there, teaching them both online and on-site instruction there. Reaching out to the community college, we're doing that with Halifax Community College. We're doing something very similar with the Roanoke Chowan Community College, and we're doing something very similar with the Beaufort Community College. Reaching out to the community colleges, delivering programs on their site, recruiting their students to our campus, does two or three things that's very important in this environment. The North Carolina legislature is very much committed to lowering the cost of education for university students and their families. Much of what is done through the community college is what they're looking at as a way to do that. One of the things that we need, and a second thing that we need, is as we're looking to recruit students, every semester students are graduating from these community colleges and they're looking for a place to continue their education. Having these seamless connections to them, having on-site relationships there, having visibility, having the relationships, if you will allow us an edge on recruiting these students. Bringing those students here, having been taught by faculty that are part of our faculty, will make a huge difference in terms of their success rates at Elizabeth City State University. It's been a busy year. A lot of very good things have happened at Elizabeth City State University. A lot of hard work has gone in. You've done a lot of that hard work, and we want you to know that we appreciate it. Where do we go from here? What we are asking you to do, and first I want to go back to that original request. I shared some stories I think are good news stories. These stories are in repository on our webpage, and we'll be looking for more and more opportunities to push them out. But we need more stories. We want you, as you go through the process of your daily business, as you see great things happening in your areas, We want you to alert us to those happenings. We want you to bring that good news to us so that we can have that constant stream of good news going out to the communities that we serve. This is what we do. And the way we will do it is continue to engage the communities, both close in and at a distance. We will continue to elevate the way we look at educating the charges that come to us. We will look at innovation in education programs. We will look at innovation in delivery. We will look at ways of bringing in more diverse populations to be educated by the institution. And then at what we know is if we're successful in doing that, that we will be empowering the region that we're charged with as a regional university supporting. We will have the opportunity to empower this region to grow economically in the ways we were originally charged to do. So our mantra is going to be engage, educate, and empower. And I think what I would add to that, and again, I boldly stole that from Bucknell, but what I would add to that is that whatever challenges Elizabeth City State University faces going forward, both the current ones and the ones we will face going forward, we will emerge through them as a result of our commitment to excellence. That's who we are. That's what we do. Thank you.